og þeir geta tekið þeir geta notað þetta hérna til að þetta ef þeir vilja.
Já.
Okay. Þeir ætla að standa hérna ekki.
Jú, jú.
Þarna, þá þetta bara klárt.
Já.
President of Iceland, Ólafur Ragnar Grímsson, dear colleagues and friends, my name is Thorsten Gunnarsson and I have the honor of moderating the next session, which is invited presentations, and where we have called on distinguished scholars and business leaders from various fields to present their perspective on the Arctic. I would like to ask all the presenters to come here at the podium. I call upon Zhang Haisheng, Yang Huigen, Steingrímur Jónsson, Halldór Jóhannsson, Leiv Lunde, and Chen Haibo to come to please come to the podium. And we welcome you all. Halldór, please step forward. We start our session with our distinguished scientists from China. They will do a joint presentation. Zhang Haisheng from Second Institute of Oceanography of China and Huigen Yang, our dear friend and colleague from Polar Research Institute of China. And they will have a presentation, an overview of Arctic research. And in the end, Huigen Yang will have a proposal for an international polar theme at Shanghai. So, welcome, both of you.
So, Your Highness, President Grimson, and distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honor for me to who participate to the second China-Nordic Arctic Research Cooperation in Symposium. First of all, I want to, on behalf of the Chinese delegation, to extend our sincere thanks to Icelandic partner and sponsor for this symposium. So I think that's in 2010, when President Grimson visited my institute, I mentioned that we want to start the research on social science for the Arctic social science. And 4 years later, then we have a quite big group. And thanks a lot for your encouragement. So basically, my institute is doing natural science research. So here I want Professor Zhang Haisheng, who was the director of the second institute of oceanography, SOA, and also the chief scientist of Chinese, the third Chinese national Arctic research expedition. So we too want to give an overview on Chinese Arctic research to this symposium. So I will do partly on behalf of Professor Zhang Haisheng to do. So I want to mention three parts. Why China? Why does China do Arctic research? And so far, what we have done, the CNARC. We have two CNARC, one for the Arctic, and one for the Antarctic. So far we have done 5 times of CNARC into the Arctic Ocean, and this year we are going to do the CNARC 6. So this CNARC 5, we arrived at Shillong, arrived at Iceland. So although China is outside of both the Arctic and Antarctic Circle, but still China is greatly influenced by the change in the Arctic, as I mentioned 2 years ago to President Grimson, that if all the Arctic and Antarctic ice sheets all melt, then the coastline of East China would retreat as much as 400 kilometers. And the most populated and prosperous areas, such as Guangzhou, Shanghai, and Tianjin, will be totally underwater. And 2 years ago, I mentioned the connection between abnormal retreat of sea ice in September 2007, and we suffered a very severe winter in our southern part in January. And indeed, we noticed with the CNARC 25, CNARC 5, we experienced Arctic experienced its new low record of sea ice coverage. And from that expedition, indeed, I was focused that 2013 we will suffer very bad weather. And now I think, although the analysis is still undergoing, but obviously people well know that last year we suffered a very prolonged heat waves for more than 40 degrees Celsius and in temperature and 40 days in time span. And then and the second one I want to mention, the Arctic is the Arctic Sea Roads. So the open of Arctic Sea Roads will greatly shorten the distances for China to North America and Europe, which will have great influences to our international trade and even the social development in the Northeast China. With CNARC 25, then you can see we so far CNARC has explored two sea road, Arctic sea roads. One is around the Northeast Passage or the Northern Sea Roads. That's the green one. We go from Bering Strait to Iceland, and then on the way back to China, we explored the Central Arctic Sea Roads. So then, about our Arctic research so far, with mainly our the coverage of the CNARC. So we have the red color. That's our regular investigation with Xuelong. We have a permanent station observation. And then last year CNARC 5, we also explored for the first time the Atlantic, Arctic Ocean. And because of the melting in of sea ice, we were able to investigate even the central Arctic Ocean. And in the Arctic, we have very, of course, because we have very limited facility. So one is our iceberg Xuelong. You know, that's the only one, and very soon we may have the second one, icebreaker. And we have the first Arctic station, the Yellow River Station on Svalbard. And yesterday, you witnessed that we are going to have an Aurora observatory in Iceland. So for the Arctic Ocean investigation, it's mainly based on our icebreaker research vessel, icebreaker Xuelong. So we used to do vessel-based investigation. And also we set up camp on sea ice. So we have ice-based investigation. And also we have second mooring system and AUV and ROV observation into the ocean. So it's a quite comprehensive investigation into the Arctic Ocean. For the CNARC 1-4, so our first expedition was in 1999, and so from those you can see that. So that's the investigations, the observation stations into the Arctic Ocean. So that's the first one. And the second one to that part, and the third, fourth, you see, because of the melting of ice, so we were able to expand to very deep into the central Arctic Ocean. And because of the crossing of the Arctic sea roads, so the expanding also, so Xuelong was able to, for the much wider than former previous expedition into the Arctic Ocean. So we go to first the Bering Sea. Yeah. The Bering Sea, Chukchi Sea, and we go to the Iceland. Yeah, so far, and with Xuelong across the Northeast Passage, we deployed one very big buoy into the Norwegian Sea. It's just in the Arctic Oscillation in core region, so to conduct continuous observation by both air and ocean observation. And we also deployed ice buoys so that we were able to measure the growing of sea ice. So So with it is drifted by the sea ice, and you can see the growth of the sea ice. And we conducted also the carbon biogeochemistry studies, especially to pay attention the carbon dioxide uptake capacity in ice-free ocean basins. So we did really have some interesting finding in through our measurement of the component carbon dioxide in both in the sea, in the air and in the sea. And we measured atmospheric aerosol as well to investigate the level growth from Arctic to Antarctic. We also measured the marine planktonic biodiversity. So sea ice melting has influence significantly on the biomass and biodiversity, and many new species were observed in the Arctic Ocean. Yeah. And we also investigated the paleoceanography study, so to study the influence of the Atlantic water. So you can see the forming abundance pattern indicates that the influence of Atlantic in the Chukchi Sea are terminated at the continent slope, and also measure the pollutants from so big changes have been noticed. And one of the core topic is the correlation between the China's climate change and the Arctic Sea ice retreat. So we have found now the surface air temperature about 20 years showing that the Arctic and the plateau become warm, but the air shell. The winter of Asia has become cold, and such it's also the main causes for the frequent weather and climate disaster of China in the winter and the spring in recent years. We have then conjugate observation of day-side solar terrestrial interaction by measuring aurora activity both in Yellow River Station in Yeosun and in Zhongshan Station, in Antarctic Zhongshan Station. So, which is under the magnetospheric spheres cusp. So, through the cusp, the solar wind plasma has direct entry into the atmosphere. So then, and the next help. So the sixth Chinese National Arctic Research Expedition is scheduled to depart Shanghai from 11th July to 24th September, in total of 75 days. This time we will not cross any Arctic Sea roads, so mainly concentrate on the Bering Sea, Chukchi Sea, Canadian Basin, and the central Arctic Ocean. I think this year we expect that the melting will be very serious, so we should be able to explore the central Arctic Ocean as before. So we are going to have many 82 observation stations and plus 7 that's flexible. It depends on the ice condition, and we will set up 9 the ice station on the sea ice. So the main objective of this expedition will be the rapid change of Arctic environment with its effect on China's climate, as before, and also pay special concentration on carbon biogeochemistry and ecosystem in a quick change environment of the Arctic Ocean. So that's the station in 36 is investigation in Bering Sea, 46 in Chukchi Sea, and the best and the ninth ice stations include the one long-term ice station lasts for 10 days. So Shillong will stop by a big sea ice for 10 days to do comprehensive measurements there. And yesterday we have started the construction of our joint Aurora Observatory in Kalhok. So now we should maybe chow. C-A-A-O-I-A-O, if we pronounce chow, then there will be a very good meaning in Chinese. Chow means a bridge. So if we, once we complete the construction of the new observatory, we should have some certain name on this observatory. So I think Chao can be a candidate for the new station. The Chao, as Hong Chao mentioned last night, the magnetic latitude of Karhok is 66 degrees. It's well located under the Earth's magnetosphere's plasma sheet, the green part of the magnetosphere. So it's quite different with our Yellow River Station and Zhongshan Station. So it have the different source of particle of Aurora. So in cooperation with this side Aurora observation and wide international cooperation, we are trying to for the new observatory, we are going to concentrate on the fundamental question on substorm, the mechanism of substorm, and to do the monitoring for space weather, which is important for space program. And also, it can be the outreach for Aurora, and also some cultural activity. But scientifically, we also want to answer the space weather's influence on the polar atmosphere and also its global influence because of the particle energy into the atmosphere. So that's the short overview on Chinese Arctic research. So may I continue? So today, now we have an excellent establishment into the Arctic region. We have the Yellow River Station and also the Aurora Observatory in Iceland. So I want to bring you a new proposal for So as I mentioned, that although China is a big country in terms of population and in terms of economy, but in terms of polar understanding, then maybe China is not as it's a very small population. For research, the quality or the degree of Arctic research, I'm so that's very keen info as an observer to the Arctic Council, that it will depend on the, I fully agree on that. But still, because there are so big or so huge knowledge is already available. As a research institute, of course, our main enterprise is to create new knowledge. But to China, I think another challenge is that for the public and different levels understanding about the Arctic situation, in Arctic knowledge, even the traditional knowledge. So in that sense, the Polar Research Institute can do very little as a huge country. So I would propose a conceptual proposal to establish an international polar theme park at Shanghai. So then I want to explain the theme, the rationales, and the concept, the park concept. And so first, the theme. So nowadays, of course, so we can maybe from one is, of course, we need to know the polar. Then the global linkage of the Arctic and Antarctic will be the main theme of the park. And the second we call xing. So zi xing he yi in Chinese, but xing, or to practice aiming to the harmony. Harmony and coherence between human and the nature. Of course, that's a very big picture and the international on the global context. So that's we'd like propose the theme of this park, the two part. And I have already mentioned. I don't think need to explain any more about the theme itself. So I want to go quickly. I have already. But all of those factors, of course, it's very important for Chinese public to understand the sea ice retreats and the climate, the connection between the dire disasters of China and the melting of the ice sheets in both Arctic and Antarctic. The sea level rise, and even the increase of polar tourism. Then the rationales I want to mention several things too. So it will be a very large challenge to increase awareness, understanding, and knowledge of the Arctic and Antarctic to Chinese. And the rest of the world as well, and also to understand the Arctic and Antarctic changes and their global impacts. The third one were to increase the awareness of its economic and social significance of the Arctic and Antarctic in a global time. And now the new administration has launched a movement, what we call China Dream. So one aim of the China Dream is to have a beautiful country. But of course, a beautiful country should be on a beautiful planet of the Earth. So that's that should be a common dream. And China has become a consulting member of ATCM in the Antarctic and an observer to the Arctic Council. So, not only the status of the observer in those organizations, but also we have related responsibilities. And as I mentioned, we have four. 1.4 billion in of population, but so far, Shilong has transported around just 4,000 person times into the the bipolar regions, so that's a very limited part. And I think some of you have visited my institute. We have done 30, more than, now this year we are celebrating our 30 years anniversary for polar expedition, but we have only 400 square meters for exhibition and interaction, so obviously it's in, and to save and protect some cultural heritage, or even for the Chinari. So then, what kind of museums or pavilions we are thinking about? So we'd like to propose to have one science museum for Chinari, yeah, so and one polar natural museum, and one Polaris Global Climate Change Observatory, which is which was brought to us by the king of Belgium in 2010, and then we are going to have an experience at a training center for polar environment, and have some Antarctic gateways and Arctic cultural villages like those powering the in the in like the expo. So I remember that President Grimson was there to for the National Day for the Icelandic powering. And also we plan to have an international polar forum, so that not only scientists but also the public can have a place to discuss those important topics, and have polar culture and innovation garden. And so that's, so then I will quickly, so of course we do need a museum for Chinari. Yeah. So that's to show what we have done in the polar regions, and to connect them by satellite link, and to show some technology developments, and our scientific engineering in the polar regions. So we, and on the top of Dome A, we do have a plan to establish an astronomic observatory there, so it can be connected to, and some heritage. And of course, the people are curious about the nature of polar regions, so animals, plants, and samples, and even aurora can. So we plan to connect the aurora observatory directly to show it into Shanghai. And as I mentioned, that's Polaris. It's, I think, one Polaris climate change observatory has been already established in Cape Town of South Africa. So globally, we plan to have three in the world, one in Brussels, one in Asia. We hope to have it in Shanghai. So it will be an interactive museum, so people can play with the climate change. So like that. And we also plan to have exploring and a training center for polar environments, like snow caves for fun. Of course, there's strong wind, super low temperature. And we also, especially today, I want to propose for the Arctic states to have the Arctic cultural village in Shanghai, like those powering in Expo. Of course, it's up to you. We propose the American village can be new Fairbanks, Canada can be new elsewhere, and the Finland, we have discussed with Rovaniemi, and Rovaniemi, the mayor of Rovaniemi, and also the Laplander University, he'd like to bring the Santa Claus into Shanghai. into this park. And how about Iceland? It should be Akureyri. So that is just a proposal for the Arctic states. So Anton is here. So how about Taimyr? I don't. So Kim is here. How about New Kiruna? So after the proposal on Arctic village, when I visited Hobart, then Hobart want to have a powering as well. So they claim. So then we identify there are five Antarctic gateway cities. So the captain, Hobart, Christchurch, Ushuaia of Argentina and Punta Arenas, say. So we'd like to invite them to have their pavilions as well. Anyway. And if we can have an international polar forum, so then even in the Arctic Circle, maybe someday can have some meeting in that polar forum as well. And we can also have cultural. So now the artists indeed is very interested in, not only scientists, but also artists are very interested in exploring in the polar natural and the polar environments and have innovation. Now we have can have maybe restaurants, animation, movies, and a lot. Something can be happen. So the park concept, it should be will be constructed by building those polar sea museums into an existing in city park, so that which can be shared both visitors and land and facility resources. And Shanghai will be Shanghai will be the host city for that. And this park, the investment or operation, it will be the local government and the central government's cooperation, and also invite international Arctic states and international organization into this park. We have many international cooperation foundation. So as I mentioned, that's the Lovania Emmy, the letter from the mayor of Lovania Emmy. So the IPTP will become the first polar sim public facility in the world, combining the city parks, scientific museums, and cultural and innovation exchange areas. It will surely become another cultural landmark, showing its charms and the uniqueness of an international city like Shanghai. So I would like to welcome the participation into the proposal, construction, and operation of the IPTP, and welcome. I'd like to have your comments and suggestions for this concept. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Huijin Yang, for a very comprehensive overview and very impressive proposal for a polar theme park. I hope we have the opportunity to discuss this further at this conference. But we need to move on with the presentations, and as time is limited, I kindly ask the presenters to not exceed 15 minutes in their presentation. Now I welcome Professor Steingrímur Jónsson from University of Akureyri, and he will present an overview of research on the freshwater in the Arctic Ocean and its impact on climate in the subsolar polar North Atlantic. So, welcome, Steingrímur.
Hey, good morning, everyone. I want to thank the organizers for allowing me to, or inviting me to speak here at this conference. And so this is the title of my talk, and you can see also that I'm not only at the University of Akureyri, I'm also working at the Marine Research Institute, which has a small branch here in Akureyri. And I am a physical oceanographer, so this is going to be very much about the ocean. Now, within the Arctic Circle, there is only 4% of the area of the world lies within the Arctic Ocean, within the Arctic Circle. And the oceanic area within this, within the Arctic Circle, oceanographers sometimes talk about it as the Arctic Mediterranean, because it is really a similar ocean to the Mediterranean, even though the circulation is actually the reverse of the proper Mediterranean. But this area is also roughly 4% of the area of the world oceans. But the Arctic Mediterranean is not so deep, so it only contains about 1% of the waters of the oceans. So it is appropriate to ask, why is it so important for the rest of the world, or why is it important at all? And the Arctic consists of atmosphere, sea ice, and sea water. And if we take a 1 meter frame and go from outer space and down to the ocean bottom, we will pass through 10 tons of atmosphere and about 2 to 4 tons of sea ice, depending on the ice condition. But then we have to go roughly 4,000 tons through 4,000 tons of seawater. And you can see the thin lines there for the atmosphere and the sea ice, and then the vast amount of seawater. And this is not to minimize the importance of the atmosphere and the sea ice. They are really hugely important for the climate, but it is to emphasize the vastness of the Arctic, or of the ocean in general. So, but what is it that makes the Arctic Ocean so special? Well, the Arctic Ocean receives 11% of the world's freshwater outflows, and this freshwater has a residence time of about 10 years in the Arctic Ocean. So it takes, on the average, 10 years for fresh water that runs into the Arctic Ocean to exit again. And this fresh water is the main characteristics of the Arctic Ocean, and it creates about 50 to 150 meter thick layer at the surface. And this is very important for the sea ice formation. And without all this fresh water, there would probably be much less sea ice in the Arctic Ocean, since you would have to cool a much thicker layer of ocean water before forming sea ice. Now, the Arctic Ocean sends this fresh water signal southwards into the North Atlantic Ocean, and this can have huge consequences for climate on the along the track of this freshwater. But the Atlantic Ocean, no, the Arctic Ocean does not just receive export water, it also has to import some water instead, and that is the Atlantic water mainly. And the Arctic Ocean receives warm, relatively warm and saline water from the south. And when this water enters the Arctic Ocean, it dives under the freshwater lid in the Arctic Ocean. And therefore, its heat is hidden beneath this freshwater surface layer. But there is enough heat in this Atlantic water to melt all the sea ice in the Arctic. So this freshwater lid is preventing the heat from the Atlantic water to reach the surface and melt the sea ice. And most of the inflow to the Arctic Ocean occurs through Fram Strait. There is also a branch in the Barents Sea. But I will show you this red arrow here is the inflow, and this is the temperature at that station with depth, and this is the salinity, and this is the outflow here on the western side of the Fram Strait. And what basically happens there is that we have some cooling of the Atlantic water, and the heat is eventually given way to the Arctic, upper layers of the Arctic and eventually to the atmosphere. And we also have this freshening with the ocean water becoming less saline as it travels through the Arctic Ocean or circulates the Arctic Ocean. Now, to the outflow of this freshwater, here you see a figure of the sea ice condition. Of course, it also exports sea ice, and we oceanographers sometimes look at sea ice. It is just another form of freshwater, because it is mainly freshwater. And here you can see the Atlantic water. It's ice-free, but as soon as it enters the Arctic Ocean, this water dives under the freshwater in the Arctic Ocean and is no longer capable of keeping the surface ice-free. But here we are at 80 degrees north, which is very far north. And this freshwater then continues along the East Greenland coast as the East Greenland current, and most of it exits through the Denmark Strait, west of Iceland, but sometimes we get some of it coming to our shores. Now, there have been changes occurring in the sources of the freshwater to the Arctic Ocean, and most of them have been increasing. So the main sources are the river discharge, and the inflow through the Bering Strait, and precipitation, and also recently there has been increased melting of glaciers, including Greenland ice sheet. Of course, most of this does not enter the Arctic Ocean proper, but it adds to the freshwater transport of the East Greenland current. And here you can see the increase in the freshwater runoff by the Eurasian rivers and the North American rivers. In the recent decade, we have seen an increase in the freshwater content in the Arctic Ocean. As you can see here, this is in thousands of cubic kilometers. So in the Beaufort Gyre, this is from the Beaufort Gyre, and the Beaufort Gyre is this, well, yellow and red area here, north of Canada and Alaska. And there has been an increase in this area of freshwater of about 6,000 cubic kilometers, which is quite a substantial amount. And recently there has been published a paper just 2 months ago where it has been stated that there has been a freshwater increase in the Arctic Ocean of about 12,000 cubic kilometers, and then over the whole Arctic Ocean. Now, this freshwater is held within this gyre by an abnormal anticyclonic wind field over the area. So if this wind field were to reverse or slacken, we could expect that more freshwater would be flowing out of the Arctic Ocean. And we, here in Iceland, we have experienced such increased flow of freshwater from the Arctic Ocean during the late 1960s. It was at its highest in 1968 north of Iceland, when we had ice cover off north and east coast of Iceland, which was quite unusual. And then this, most of this freshwater continued through Denmark Strait and appeared in the region west of Greenland in 1969 to 70. And then it continued and was off the Newfoundland and Labrador in 71 to 72. And then it crossed the Atlantic and appeared in the eastern part of the Atlantic in 1976. Now the size of this great salinity anomaly, as it was called, was about 10,000 cubic kilometers of excess freshwater over 5 years. So this is a little less than the increase in freshwater content that has been observed now. So, and what did this freshwater anomaly do? So this shows the biomass of the Norwegian spring spawning herring, which was, this is one of the largest fish stocks in the world, if not the largest. So it was up to 14 million tons, the biomass. And after or during this salinity anomaly, this fish stocks completely collapsed. And this was probably not just due to the cooling, but because we kept on fishing for this stock, even though it was diminishing because of the deteriorating conditions. And it completely collapsed, and it took it 30 years to recover. But now it has recovered, and now it is back to the same or similar size as it was before the Great Salinity Anomaly. And you can see here, we had a very much lowering of the salinity in north of Iceland and also a reduction in temperature. Now this continued to West Greenland, where there was a thriving cod fishery of about 300,000 tons, which is a lot. And this also collapsed after this great salinity anomaly passed it, and it has not recovered yet. So this has had great consequences, and you can read that about this in the paper by Hamilton, which I'm also a co-author of. And there we also discuss some of the social implications of this great salinity anomaly. Now I just have one more slide, and I hope the 15 minutes have not gone. So I just wanted to remind you about what kind of an environment we are now living in. Now this is two parameters, the concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere, which is this blue curve, and the acidity of the ocean, or pH. And here is the present, and you can see that no human being has ever lived in the conditions or the environment that we are living in now. And I think we are now in entering new territory, and then you should always be prepared for the unexpected. We do not know really where we are going. And there is also a path here for the future, which is just predicting that we are going even further away from the environment that we have had for the last hundreds of thousands of years. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Steingrímur, for a very interesting presentation. And we had the warning, be prepared for the unexpected, which we will discuss further at this conference. But we will continue and just remind you that I hope in the end we will have some time for questions and answers. But our next speaker is Mr. Halldór Jóhannsson, who is director of Arctic Portal, and he will talk about knowledge and information exchange in the Arctic, especially with regard to transport and infrastructure. So please, Halldór.
Distinguished guests, it's an honor for me to be here and be able to talk to you about information. I'm referring to information as basically everything around us. New technologies, new gadgets, etc., increase our awareness and our accessibility. But the most important thing, of course, is I like this phrase very much, because all the information, all the data in the world doesn't mean anything unless we can convert it into knowledge. We have to be able to make it talk to us and talk to others in a way that we can understand, that we can share the information. So we need to increase efficiency of the information exchange. And, of course, the international cooperation is of greatest importance. So I'll go through a few pointers. First of all, of course, we all recognize that there are new conditions in the Arctic today. And it seems that the future is holding a lot of opportunities, but of course, at the same time, there's a lot of threats. We all know these changes from Cold War to cooperation. We know about the Arctic Council, etc., and we definitely do know about the increased global interest. And why is all of this? Well, there's the Arctic, and Steingrímur has just talked about the ocean and the area. We have the different definitions to what is really the Arctic and how to define it has been a discussion for quite a long time. But I like actually the definition of the Northern Forum, because it's basically the people that have Arctic winters that are Arctic. So I think we, of course, have to, and that's becoming more and more evident, of course, that the climate changes, or the changes in the weather patterns, are bringing the effect of winter further down than ever before. And then in Dr. Yang's presentation with the ice in China, that brings it more evident that we can't really define what is the Arctic and what not, and probably it changes year by year. But we do know about the economic zones, and I'm showing you here some pictures from the mapping system that we have at the Arctic Portal, because one of the most important things is to bring the knowledge, bring the science to the different users. And we have to be able to present the information in a way that people understand. Not just people like yourselves, policymakers and scientists, but also educators and the general public. This map shows the resources in the Arctic. We know that the governance in the Arctic is quite clear, so there's not much dispute about that. But we also have heard about the fish stocks and the changes in the fish stocks. And when we put all these things together, and we know about the changes in the ice, how it's getting less and less. And in a recent study by the Access Project, they claim that the ice mass in the Arctic has decreased 75% since the 1980s. And, of course, that is very, very significant. But we also know that there is ice in the wintertime. So the conditions in the Arctic, of course, are very severe. And the most important thing, of course, is to understand it. Permafrost is another factor. Steingrímur mentioned the flow of freshwater into the Arctic. This is partly and very probably very largely because of the thawing of the permafrost. So it's bringing more freshwater into the Arctic, and also the freshwater is coming earlier in the year than it used to come. So that actually brings more biomass into the Arctic. So it's very important to understand all of that. And then, of course, we have people in the Arctic. And we have different groups of people that have rights and have been there for a long time. So when we start putting these things together, we understand that there are opportunities and there's also threats. And this is the importance of information exchange today, is to be able to pull these things together so that we can increase our understanding of the different factors. And as also pointed out by the previous speakers, the changes are so rapid that we need current information. We it's not enough to have like 10-year-old data. We need current information. So Arctic shipping is one of the issues that has been greatly discussed before. And I'm just going to put in a few pointers about what then could be the key issues of future Arctic shipping. There is has been work on polar code, a mandatory polar code, and it is expected to become in force in 2016. This is very important because that can deal with the classification of ships, etc. Deals with tracking and so forth. We've had mention of the search and rescue before. But one of the biggest issues about Arctic shipping today, for example, insurance companies, they don't really know what to deal with. They don't really know how to deal with the current conditions. So this is, of course, an extremely limiting factor to the developments. And then, of course, we need to know and understand all the environmental issues and cross-reference that with the Arctic infrastructure and, again, with the people of the Arctic, etc. So I've had, in the past, many good discussions with our former foreign minister about the importance of this knowledge and how China, for example, why China should be concerned. Because all of these issues are not just an Arctic issue, it's a global issue, of course. This map shows the international search and rescue definitions. And as you can see, the area around Iceland is not small when you consider that we are only 330,000 people that are supposed to cover this area. So, and then again, the Russian area is very big, and there's not a lot of people actually living in this area. And look at Greenland. And I mean, this is a huge area, and it's very complicated and complex. So, again, international cooperation is essential to make this happen. And I'm just going to go through a few examples of international cooperation that is of interest in this context. AMATI, the Arctic Maritime and Aviation Database, is an extremely interesting example. I've had the pleasure of being a part of that, but that brings together Coast Guards in the different Arctic countries. And actually, there is now a database of infrastructure. But this database is a standalone database today. It's not merged with other databases yet. So, of course, this information is extremely important, but it's still only a layer. But there is information now about all the airports, all the harbors in the Arctic. And the thinking, of course, is that it will reduce the response time. If something happens, or when it happens, we have information about the closest airport, who to contact, etc., etc. So it's already available. Another very important initiative of the Arctic Council is SEON, Sustaining Arctic Observation Networks. There's a lot of observation going on in and around the Arctic, but the efforts to date to coordinate that and thematically overlay the information is still lacking. There's been reports have been made about the monitoring in the different Arctic countries. Those are available in a database. You can see on a map where the monitoring is going on, but you still can't overlay the information. Another important initiative that I have the pleasure of being a partner in is the EU Arctic Information Center. And why is this important? Well, it's important because We live in one globe. And this is a partnership of 19 European organizations and institutions that are working together on increasing information exchange with emphasis on the EU. So it's information to the EU about the Arctic and to the Arctic about the EU and what the EU is doing. And one of the results is on compendium of which explains and shows what the EU has been doing. You may not know it, but the EU has is the area that has spent the biggest amount of money on research in the Arctic. They've spent more than 200 million euros in the last decade on the Arctic. But again, too much of that information is scarcely stored. So it's a challenge to improve that. One of the outcomes also are fact sheets on different issues, and you can actually see those on arcticinfo.eu. These include, for example, Arctic maritime time transport overviews. So it's peer-reviewed information from both stakeholders and scientists, because, of course, it's very important also to realize and remember that there's no science without business, there's no business without science. It has to connect. Page 21, I mentioned the permafrost project, and I just want to show you because it's also something that we are working on very closely. The outreach part is so important, to introduce and teach to the different people what is, for example, an active layer in permafrost, and why is that important, and why are changes to that important. through that cooperation and through this funding that the EU has been providing, we've actually managed now to make a global database on permafrost. A global database on permafrost has not been available before. And this includes cooperation from China, from Japan, from Russia, from the US, Canada, the EU countries, of course. So it's an incredibly interesting initiative. And it also tells you a lot about the changes of the world today, that it's actually possible to do this from Akureyri. The information exchange can be done from wherever to wherever. So to be able to go through this information now in a open database and start to study the ground temperatures, etc., is hugely important. But the most important thing today is to work on a data interface so that this information on permafrost can be layered together with other information. We need to know about infrastructure. What are the potential changes of permafrost? How are they going to affect infrastructure? How has the vegetation changed? How is it dealing with the oceans, et cetera, et cetera? So we need to work on a way to thematically layer and compare monitoring data and information. And this is an international thing. This is what CEON has been trying to do, but I'm still saying trying because we haven't had enough result yet. But I am very optimistic that this will happen in the near future because I feel the change of attitude. This attitude of this is my data as it has been before, it's changing. So scientists are more and more realizing that their data is not valuable unless it's comparable and interoperable with other data. So there's a change of attitude. So I'm very optimistic that on the way forward now, we can achieve this so that we can link the different databases together and be able to present the information so that it's usable to policymakers, to scientists, to stakeholders, etc. And we are actually working on a project now. And I'm happy to say that PRIC is interested in cooperation, the National Snow and Ice Data Center is interested, the United Nations is interested. So there is significant attitude change. Again, just quickly to how is this affecting Iceland? We have hopes that we can become a service center to the Arctic so that our knowledge and our global location can become a benefit to us. We know that we have prospective oil and gas areas next to Iceland, and there's also great prospect by Greenland. So, of course, Icelanders have started to study how can this affect Iceland and could we potentially become active. And in an Icelandic way, of course, the competition has started before the opportunities. So instead of maybe marketing the country and marketing the opportunities, we started fighting about where to locate the harbor and so forth. But again, it is an opportunity, and foreigners have started to realize that this may be very important. So agreements have been made with for example, in the northeast, there is a German company, Bremen Ports, is now looking at the opportunities. Again, we can thank the then Minister of Industry for initiating research, which is now, 7 years later, developing into something. And that's another message, of course. We need to have the information to be able to clinch the opportunities in a respectful way, sustainable way, when they arise. And what we learned from the Arctic is everything takes time. But that doesn't mean we should wait with the information collection and the science. On the contrary, we need to know what's happening. But we also need to be able to then respond. But this is a picture from that area. I just wanted to throw this picture in there because education is also so important. And we've been working with many good partners in the Arctic on educational tools that link to the information so that we can educate our people, and not just the people in the Arctic, but also people out from outside the Arctic, using distance learning opportunities. And by using distance learning opportunities, you can bring in people with knowledge, like in this case, Bob Correll. He was sitting in Florida educating people in the Arctic. It brings us together using the opportunities. And last but not least, it has been mentioned before, the importance of business. We are happy to be working with the Northern Forum in Yakutsk in Russia on a database on business and culture. Business, culture, tourism is very interrelated. And this is an initiative that I hope will help in cooperation. Arctic Council is definitely doing something with the Economic Forum, but bringing it down to the small and medium businesses is very important, because that increases the sustainability and increases our joy of life, because it's all about the people, of course. So I will stop with that note, and thank you very much.
Yes, thank you, Halldór. Thank you for keeping the time limit and information and access to relevant information is highly important. But then we go to our next speaker, which is Leiv Lunde from Fridtjof Nansen Institute, and he will present a book project, Arctic Policies of the Nordic Countries. So, please.
Thanks. Let me see if I can ask. Here we go. Yes, thanks. I'm very happy to be here. I'm Leiv Lunde. I'm the director of the Fridtjof Nansen Institute. It's a policy research institute in Norway, in outside Oslo, that has been focusing and doing a lot of policy research on Arctic issues for more than 40 years. I'm very glad to be here in the context of CNARC. Thanks a lot to the Chinese and the Icelandic hosts who have took the initiative to CNARC, and also to the Icelandic hosts who are organizing this conference. I will speak later today on another issue, but I've been asked to share with you just some quite early thoughts on one of the first real products of the CNARC cooperation. I was happy to be part of the inaugural ceremony of CNARC in Shanghai in December. And already there, we started discussing, at the initiative of Dr. Yang Huigen, a book project that should be given high priority because there is such an interest and high demand in China for learning more about the Nordic Arctic, to both learn more about the Nordic countries, the Nordic approaches to Arctic issues, and also both of the Nordic region and of the Nordic countries. And we also discussed in discussing this book project on what the Nordic countries can learn from China and how we can cooperate in the future. So I will be also help you, I think, with the time because I'm going to be brief. But I will share with you some sort of initial setup for this book for you to discuss and also provide input to in the coming both in the conference here and in the coming months. We were supposed to have the assembly of CNARC and discuss the book manuscript there before this presentation. But now the schedule has changed. But I think it should be okay. But so we have discussed a CNARC book on, and we are working on a CNARC book on Nordic Chinese Arctic interfaces. As I said, there is a strong Chinese interest in Nordic Arctic experience and policies and competencies. There is also, we believe, a solid case for focus on Nordic Arctic identities, on the similarities, but also on the differences. That is also coming from Norway. I think this is a very interesting opportunity because it's for Norway, it's many times been just as natural to think about Norway and Russia as a key Arctic region. We haven't been that much focusing on the Nordic Arctic. So of course, Russia will be an extremely important Arctic player and the most important Arctic player. But the Nordic countries together is a very interesting region, and this is an interesting opportunity. So then, it's important to explore where and how Nordic and Chinese interests meet in Arctic waters and on land. And then we also agree that we need a popular book for a broad audience in China, but also globally and in the Nordic region. We will do more, as was also mentioned initially today by our Icelandic host. We produce within the CNARC context in the coming years also more academic research on the policy research on the Arctic. But this first product will be a more popularized book for a broader audience, and we believe it will contribute to the building of a cooperative CNARC platform and identity and be a catalytic product that will sort of encourage creative cooperation between the partners. And already, as I mentioned, the book idea was discussed in Shanghai first in December, and we also had a meeting in April in Shanghai with Yang Huigen, Yang Jian from the SIS, and also Lasse Heinonen from the University of Lapland in Finland. So together with me, we make up an informal editorial committee for the book. And I should also mention that Fridtjof Nansen Institute, together with the Polar Research Institute here, represented by Kim Holmen, are the Norwegian CNARC members. So then just a few words about, more specific words about how we are foreseeing the book emerging. We will look into, so this is a very preliminary book structure, but just to give you ideas of what we are thinking, and it's a result of a brainstorming in Shanghai just a few weeks back. We want to look into the Nordic region also more in general, because we think we see a lot of interest on that in China. We will have short country briefs, historical context, identity and values, and illustrative maps. And then we will, of course, introduce then the Nordic Arctic, because that is there are many similarities between the Arctic regions in the Nordic countries, but there are also differences. So we will go through sort of brief country studies, engage researchers in each of the Nordic countries to have Arctic geography, population, industry, and also policy position contributions. And then to discuss unity, diversity, similarities, differences, and the significance of Nordic Arctic contributions. But then this is, the next major part of the book will be broadening the picture, and the Nordics meet the world and China. We will discuss the Nordic Arctic in a global context to look at how we fit into global regimes with Arctic mandates, including UN environmental bodies, the IMO, and related organizations. And we need to take into account the significance of not only of China, but of Asia's growing Arctic role. We have the European institutions and Arctic Council and other regional and sub-regional bodies. And then to analyze, and this will be jointly with Chinese experts and Nordic experts, the Nordic Arctic in a global perspective. And then towards the end of the book, this is just, again, a preliminary proposal, narrow in on the more specific dynamic of cooperation and opportunities and challenges in the interface between the Nordic countries and the Nordic region and China in the Arctic. So we will have then jointly between Nordic and Chinese researchers discuss Nordic Arctic ambitions and contributions and the Nordic expectations on what China expectation what China brings to the Arctic table, and then the other way around, Chinese Arctic ambitions and contributions and expectations on the Nordic, what China expects from the Nordic countries in the Arctic. And then to have a more sort of policy-oriented finalizing chapter on the opportunities and challenges in future Sino-Nordic Arctic cooperation. So this is very, very brief, preliminary. We are going to discuss it in the assembly meeting before dinner today and move on further. We hope to move quite rapidly. We will nominate authors, get some funding, and hope to produce this book quite quickly, because there's a lot of demand for it. And we hope to, and we will do this at the same time as there will be commissioned more sort of heavily analytical, research-oriented both articles and books within the framework of CNARC in the time to come. So this is a kind of pilot product with a broad audience. So I think I'll stop there. Thanks.
So thank you, Leiv, for a very exciting project on this book, and we wish you and all the authors best luck in writing this book. And as Leiv mentioned, we will use the opportunities of the conference to sort of map the next steps in the writing. Then we have a video presentation from Mr. Chen Haibo from Shanghai Yipinghui Culture Development, and it's called Midnight Sunshine, a Chinese artist's exploration to the Arctic. And okay, you want to?
Here. Does it work? Yeah.
I will wait for the technician. Okay.
centuries, human beings have never stopped exploration into the mysterious Arctic. Among them, there was a group of Chinese artists. Masters of traditional Chinese porcelain art, Zhou Wongzhen and Wang Menghu never thought that one day they would be able to sail overseas and set foot on islands so far, which are almost at the end of the world, while in their 80s. That is the Arctic, the northernmost landmass on planet Earth. Everything started from a news report on May 15, 2013. China was accepted as a permanent observer to the Arctic Council on that day. When the good news came out, Mr. Chen Haibo, the Shanghai Workstation Chief of the Arts Evaluation Committee under the Ministry of Culture of China, determined that it's the time to deepen cultural exchange and cooperation between Chinese and Northern artists. Porcelain has naturally become the best medium of cultural communication, for its long history and unique tradition as characteristic Chinese arts. The team is formed with both young and senior artists, all famous the Chinese porcelain world. Their Arctic exploration started from a porcelain arts communication in Iceland, a place of gorgeous natural beauty and mystery, where the Chinese were received warmly by their hosts. In the National Gallery, Chinese artists presented their sincerely prepared porcelain works to their Icelandic colleagues and friends. The amazing highlight of this arts communication happened when artists of both countries came to work together on July 16, 2013. In an artist workshop, local artists warmly welcomed their Chinese friends and invited them to create art pieces together. When the rice paper and brushes from China rolled out onto the table, a breathtaking dialogue of art and culture started, and no one wanted to stop it. Although spoken in different languages, art itself is the best language, explaining and communicating everything about beauty and love. Setting off from an Icelandic port, the artists started their inspirational journey into the Arctic. In Svalbard, scientific research stations gathered from all over the world. The artists were very excited. It might be the first time in history that so many artists paid visit to a site of Arctic research. It is a salute from the artists towards the frontier of science. On the boundless ocean, the artists encountered the most astonishing scenery of natural beauty of the Arctic, the midnight sunshine. With the beautiful sun shining in the sky and crystal icebergs in the sea, the ship was about to leave. On the ship, the artists couldn't help but start to paint. A lonely polar bear has seemingly grasped the heart of young artist Mr. Jun Ruchu, as well as the hearts of those around him. Humans have never ceased exploring the mysteries of nature, and their scientists have been the bravest pioneers. Scientists, however, have never been and never will be alone in such exploration. Indeed, without the love and beauty that artists bring forward, a human being's understanding of nature and the world that surrounds them can never be complete.
Yes, I want to thank Mr. Chen Haibo for his excellent and inspiring video presentation, which shows the importance of culture in our cooperation. Now I would like all our panel to come to the podium again, and we have a session for questions and answers. We have here mobile speakers, so and we will have assistance from our staff to bring you the mobile speakers. Okay, so we have some time for questions and answers, and I would like you, when you ask a question, you stand up and please state your name and where you come from. So the floor is open, and everyone in the panel would be happy to answer your questions and comments. So, please. Yes.
Yes, my name is Rasmus Bertelsen from Aalborg University, Denmark. I'm sure we were all very inspired by the video we just saw about that artistic exchange between Iceland and China. And that makes me think about, there has been a lot of attention to commodities in the Arctic, to raw materials, energy, shipping, of bulk shipping. But my question to the panel is basically, what kind of prospects do you see for an Arctic, for an innovative Arctic, a knowledge-based Arctic, for Arctic communities whose economies are not based on natural resources, but much more based on human capital? Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any other question? Anyone else who wants to put a question forth? Okay, then we just turn to the panel, and And start with Halldór.
Yeah, thanks, Rasmus. I think it's a very good question. If we just look at Akureyri as an example, we probably have some 80 jobs now just related to the Arctic, and this is like knowledge-based jobs. I think that's very important. And a similar thing is happening in Tromsø, and it's spreading. And I mentioned the cooperation with the Northern Forum, which is like a, in a way, grassroots-based cooperation, more the municipal, regional level. So I think we have a lot of opportunities in culture and tourism is something that we can definitely increase, but we need to increase the information sharing. I can tell you, I was lucky enough to take part in the preparation and the visit last year of the artists, and it took some effort to break down some of the barriers that were between people. But when they sort of clicked, it was really amazing to see the chemistry. But the lack of understanding is definitely an obstacle in the beginning. Thank you.
Leiv, please.
Okay, two observations, sort of in two somewhat different directions. First of all, I think it's a very important question, and we even started discussing that a bit in the reception last night. It's really there were pictures in the video from Svalbard and from the Ålesund, there's a big discussion in Norway now and will continue in the future on the role of coal as the main sort of bulwark of the economy in Svalbard. More and more questions, more and more criticism because of the climate change contributions of coal. So again, the question is becoming very much what is going to be the future bulwark of the economy of Svalbard. And I think quite a lot of the answer is in the direction of Rasmus' question of really building and developing a knowledge economy. Of course, tourism also and a knowledge economy in a rather broad concept. There is already the university in Longyearbyen. But I think it's going to be very important to be creative and to think of new ways when there are such significant environmental and climate change challenges to the way that we are approaching Arctic issues. But on the other hand, and I will revert to that also in my presentation later, I think it's not an either or; it's both. And it's a bit dangerous to look at all the economic issues relating to raw materials, to oil and gas, and to mining and to shipping as kind of traditional conventional industries, and then looking at all that is new and modern. It's a matter of fact that there are few industries that are so advanced, that are so future-oriented as the oil and gas industry, for instance, if you look at what they are achieving, and also in many of the other industries. And there is a lot of environmental improvements and extremely advanced scientific efforts. There is this proposal, for instance, by the Norske Veritas, DNVGL, who specializes in LNG, liquefied natural gas, as a fuel for shipping. And they have proposed that all ships that go through the Arctic should be fueled by LNG, because that would significantly reduce the risks of environmental disaster. So just an example of the need to think broadly in terms of the knowledge economy. So it's not an alternative to the current economic order, but it's extremely important supplement, and we need to find ways to harness the best of our scientific efforts to combine more or less the conventional economic developments in the Arctic with all the new opportunities that come with modern technology. Thanks.
Thank you. Eugene Yang, please.
Yes. So I think the artists' exploration in so the nature of Arctic is there, but so far, so many exploration has been done by scientists. But still, to understand the nature, we really can have the different angle or the different perspective. So I think the artist's exploration will be a new, especially for those people who live outside of the Arctic region. So, and for the Oriental country, we have long tradition about not. It's about the beauty or about the life. So, so that will be for the if we talk about North meet North meets East. So. It's really a good angle for future cooperation.
Anyone else from the panel? Okay, there's this gentleman here, and then it's next to Össur Skarphéðinsson. Okay, please.
Okay, thanks so much. I'm Hong Yuanyu from Shanghai Institute for International Studies. I have three questions for the panelists. The first is about the interconnections between Arctic and global governments, because there are so many interconnections or nexus between Arctic changes and global energy, food, and environmental securities. How are we to provide more knowledge to solve this interconnections between Arctic change and global energy, food, and security, and particularly between the Arctic change and other regions, climate change and environmental changes. So the first question about the interconnections in Arctic research. Second is about a new issue suggested by the US and the UK's scientists about geoengineering, because we have quite a lot very bad scenario for Arctic environmental changes and Arctic changes and the global security. So I want to ask a question about the geoengineering and the Arctic changes. If we can use the geoengineering to push or to help the Arctic change in a positive way for humankind, or not. The second is about the geoengineering. The last about the Arctic resources and the global energy scarcity or global energy. Because of the uneven distribution of the resources in the world, we still have quite a lot of energy, food scarcity in Africa, in India. So how are we to use the Arctic resources to solve this the global equity problem, and to make such kind of resources to meet the demands of the many people in energy and resource scarcity. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Is there anyone in the panel who can respond to these questions? Dave, please.
Well, I won't keep you away from lunch, because one could have long answers to such deep questions. But just a few very quick comments. I think on your first issue on the interconnections, I must say I was very encouraged by the presentation on the Arctic portal on all the advanced mechanisms we have now today on really teaching us about these interconnections and so I think that at least some of the easy part of the answer is really exploiting and capitalizing on on promising initiatives like the Arctic portal, and also with the priority that you give to education and to really reach out to people. On your last question, I think it's a huge issue, but I think there's one dilemma here, because there is a lot of the poor world, Africa, other developing regions need energy. They need more energy, but then we have climate change, and we need to use energy. We both need to use to use other energy sources and to reduce emissions. So there we have the Arctic dilemma, because the climate change is opening up the Arctic for more oil and gas exploration. And then supporters of further oil and gas exploration in the Arctic will then say that this it's important to provide oil and gas to the markets, also to keep down price and to make it manageable for poor people to get access to modern energy. And it's also in a sort of low risk politically the Arctic region. So, but then we have the concern about climate change, and you also. We probably saw the Greenpeace ship boarding a Norwegian operator moving towards the Arctic to start exploration for oil and gas. So I think your question is pointing both to the relevance of the Arctic to some, not all, but some of the global challenges in terms of poverty, but also to the dilemmas in how the world is going to meet them. And I think we are going to discuss many of these dilemmas later on in the conference. And just one word on geoengineering. I'm a political scientist, but I'm a technology optimist. But some of the stuff that I've seen on geoengineering is going a bit beyond my comprehension. And so even though I'm a technological optimist, I think the burden of evidence is on those who think that you can solve the problems by geoengineering. But this is a non-expert response.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, we move then to a question from Össur Skarphéðinsson, former Minister of Foreign Affairs.
Well, I would rather like to say that I'm a formerly of Her Majesty's Department of Agriculture, Fisheries and Food, even though I'm presently a member of. But is this working?
No, it's fine.
Well, I have a question to Halldór Jóhannsson. I would like him to elaborate a little bit on. His concept of Iceland being a servicing hub for the Arctic. Does he particularly focus solely on gas and oil? And to Huigen Zhang, well, I thought the proposal for the Polar Park. Is great. And I very much would be interested to listen to some further elaboration, for example, on when will it start to being constructed? How big will it be? What will the costs be? And as an Icelander, I'm of course very interested to know if it isn't absolutely sure that Icelandic puffins will be there. But as well, one political question, because he is on the Council of the great city of Shanghai, so I'm allowed to ask him a political question. He is also a great specialist in the sailing proposed new transport routes over the Arctic. So I'd like to ask him whether recent geopolitical events will reduce the interest of China in the central route over the Arctic and perhaps lead them to put greater focus on cooperation with Russia on the northeastern pathways? That's an easy question.
Okay.
On Iceland's opportunities, no, I don't focus solely on oil and gas, but I think oil and gas, of course, will become very important to us. I mentioned about 80 jobs already in Akureyri focusing on the Arctic, and we at the Arctic Portal, for example, we have 15 very good people working from six nationalities.
And we are basically a service company. We provide information, we deal with information, and I think there's many opportunities in the same direction. I was recently up in Tromsø at the Kongsberg company. They have 133 people working on just reading from satellites. So, and there's a lot of, and they are expanding 20% per year. So there's a lot of opportunities in service-related jobs, not just on oil and gas. Search and rescue is a big issue as well. Tourism is growing in the Arctic, so support to that is also very important. And as you mentioned, transarctic shipping, I have listened to presentations. It came out in the presentation in China last year that there was a forecast that by the year 2030, transarctic shipping, cargo shipping, would be as much as all the cargo shipping in the world today. And these are like very interesting prospects. These can only come about with very good access to information, and I hope to see Iceland as the center of such information management.
Thank you, Aldor. Huigen Yang, please.
Yes, thanks a lot for the excellent questions. So first I want, maybe I need to ask you again for the second question because I didn't. But first, I want to answer to your first question. Yeah, yeah. Here I have brought here is a conceptual your proposal as a park of polar sea. So in my mind, that the scale of that park, we are aiming to have in size, we are going to have about 40,000 square meters. So if you have been to Shanghai, maybe you can have the Shanghai Science and the Science Museum. It's, I think, quite similar. So that means we are anticipate about 3 million in visitors a year. So that's the scale, and of course that's a big dream, of course it should not stop as just a dream. If we want to move it into a project, then there are many important steps need to go through. So today it's really a conceptual proposal to the Shanghai Municipal Government, because first of all, we need the Shanghai municipal government to adopt it and put it into its urban development plan of the city. So now we are at the end, almost at the end of our 5-year plan. So in time scale, I do hope that we can by this year, the latest by the end of next year, that the Shanghai municipal government would accept that concept and put it into its urban development plan. So I think that's so we have we still have some time, but not too much. Once we have that one, still, because that's a very big one, the municipal government also need to get permission from the central government. So so in my opinion, indeed I did this proposal in this January to the Shanghai Congress, and already the government, the Shanghai municipal government, has won a hearing in last month, in May, and it's quite favorable for, I think, most of the related departments of municipal government like this idea. So Shanghai now is Now we are having a big project at the Disneyland. So, but of course that so it's a scale such as with Disneyland the scale. So optimistic. Once this, because that's the concept. Of course, the whole day park it can be it can last for many years. But now, right now, the Lingang, I don't know whether you know, in Shanghai, we have a Lingang area. That's a new satellite town of Shanghai. Originally designed for 0.7 million in population, but now recently it is raised into 1.2 million in of that new region. So one choice is to have this new to have this park in the Ringgang area, and for that part, they do have a green belt in that city, so it's possible to accommodate it. And the other choice or other candidate is in Shanghai. We have a Baoshan region. So this is it's very famous for the Bao steel, one of the largest steel maker, and now Bao steel is going to move out from that region. So, and it have some space to host that one as well. So there are some feasibility, and I'm quite optimistic about the future. So once by the end of next year, if they can decide, then I think the Polaris observatory can be very soon, and also the Chinari, the museum for the Chinari can start soon in 2 or 3 years. So that's my my expectation about that proposal. And for your second question, I need to.
What I'm really referring to is the fact that there have been some conflicts relating to the Ukraine, and this has led to a more cooperation between China and Russia.
And I am wondering whether that may reduce that the increased cooperation that we see, at least in Western media, between Russia and China. I'm wondering whether that may lead to a reduced interest by China in the
central pathway over the Arctic, and that China will focus
in future more on cooperation with Russia on the northeastern passage over
the Arctic. Well,
it's not a pretty question, it's an easy question.
Yes, of course. Yeah, we are the strategic partner. I think with the new situation, I believe that we will have more and more cooperation in the Northeast Passage for sure. And indeed, that's the most realistic part for the Arctic Sea Route.
Okay, so I thank you all for your good participation, that we have exceeded our time limits, not very much though, which I am grateful for, and I want to thank the presenters for their excellent presentations, and you, the participants, for good and constructive comments and questions. Now we have lunch time, but we will start here at 1 o'clock, and I will ask the presenters to bring their presentations, if they have power presentations, to bring them here 10 minutes to 1 o'clock to load the computer, so that will not delay the meetings. And finally, there is
announcement. There is a Chinese business delegation here, and they will be in the afternoon visiting companies in the Eyjafjörður area. And there is an announcement that bus leaves from the university 2:45 from the main entrance here. So thank you again for your good participation this morning. See you at lunch and at 1:00.
Thank you for your giving me an opportunity to put the questions. Ask a question.
Yes, no problem.
Where we have lunch? In the upstairs.
Continue. You just take the corridor and then the stairs, and you will see it to your right. Here's the front door.
It's okay.
So then you look at yours?
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Can you come with the company?
Yeah.
Thanks so much. So I put my coat and put my... it's okay.
It will not be locked, but it's okay to leave.
Thanks so much.
Thank you. Jónsson og ég eyði út það sem búið. Það að stýra mappan eitthvað. Okay.